Good evening, everyone. So, this is the first time that I introduce a Heller lecturer. Elon claims that that's not true, that I already did it, but at my age, I don't remember anymore. So, in 2002, Morven and Michael Heller from London decided to donate an annual sum of £15,000 to establish at the ICNC a high-profile series of lectures entitled The Heller Lecture Series in Computational Neuroscience. The primary aim of this unique lecture series is to acquaint the interested public with the most exciting research advances in the brain sciences. Every year, four world-renowned researchers visit the Hebrew University, deliver talks, and interact with the students and faculty members of our center. This evening, the Heller lecturer is Lars Chitka from the Research Center for Psychology at Queen Mary University in London. I'm not going to be very long. I would just like to mention that Professor Chitka's research represents a type of research that's not represented at LSEC, which is the use of model animals for addressing very specific questions that are hard to address with the usual rodent models that we are using. In his case, it's bees, who have a very rich behavioral repertoire and amazing learning capacities. So I'm looking forward very much to the lecture. Before we start, there's one last formal step, which is giving to the lecturer the certificate. So here's the certificate. It says, the Heller Lecture Series in Computational Neuroscience awards this certificate of recognition and appreciation to Lars Chitka for his contribution to academic inquiry and exchange at the Interdisciplinary Center for Neural Computation, MUJ Safra Campus, Gizat Ram, Jerusalem, Israel. Thank you very much.
Thank you very, very much. All right. Well, thank you very, very much for this very kind introduction and the invitation. I hope I can sort of live up to your generosity and expectations. I'll start with my acknowledgments because no one ever listens to them at the end anyway, or I might just plainly forget them. So the work that I'm going to talk about largely was done by Erica Dawson, Clint Perry, Ellie Leadbeater, Olli Lukkola, Mathieu Lioreau, Sylvain Olem, and I'm just doing the talking. So first of all, this isn't my first visit to Israel. The first one was in 1982, and this was a little bit more cumbersome than flying in on a plane. In those days, we hitchhiked. That was a popular mode of transport, but I think there were very few people who actually chose the land route via Jordan and Syria and so on. Recently, my mum showed me a letter that had written at some point saying that in my previous letter, when I claimed we were going to stay in Turkey for a few more weeks, I just made that up because what we did instead was hitchhike through Syria. So this is the map that shows my travel. If it went up a little bit higher, so the black line is where we traveled, there was this big bend in the curve because there was a civil war then in Hama, not in the entire country, more a local civil war, but we had to hitchhike around it in a big arc. You can see here that there are several versions of the Israeli-Egypt border, which was highly dynamic in those days. But it proved a lot easier to cross. Actually, that border was hardly guarded than from Jordan to Israel, which was slightly more difficult. Anyway, I was traveling with this dude here, who later became a famous artist. He's doing some early sketching, Rainer Splitt. Anyway, that was a long, long time ago. Science. So what I'm going to talk to you about today, and hopefully convince you that you can do some fairly impressive social learning type things with very little brains. And that's in contrast to an idea that's floating around in vertebrate behavioral ecology and neuroscience, and that's that to do great things you have to have large brains. I'll comment more on that in the other lecture on Thursday. Today, I'll demolish that idea for social learning, or hopefully at least partially. So the idea was roughly expressed by Dunbar among others, who observed that primates with larger groups tend to have slightly larger brains. And phrased it up in such a way that these large brains reflect the computational demands of the complex social systems that characterize the order. From one of his analyses that's been controversial, but at least there seems to be some form of correlation, that if you look at neocortex ratio, i.e. cortex divided by rest of brain, and correlate that with group size, then you find that primates with larger groups tend to have larger neocortex ratios. So far, so good. Now, you will notice that the group sizes here between, 5 and a bit under 100 are fairly diminutive compared to the kinds of societies that I work with. But in general, I guess there is this idea implicit in this observation is that in order to do complex computations in some way, then you need relatively large hardware, biological hardware, to do that. Now, in the opposite direction, an idea was phrased half a century ago by Richard Feynman, who at a time when good computers filled entire rooms, and perhaps people thought that even better computers would one day have to fill factory halls, pointed in the opposite direction, and suggested that with a lecture famously entitled "There's Plenty of Room at the Bottom," that you could, if you do things elegantly, minimize the size of computers quite drastically. And at one point in this lecture, asked why can't we write the entire 24 volumes of the Encyclopedia Britannica on the head of a pin? Now that might have seemed wholly absurd at the time. It's not too far from the truth nowadays, of course. So to what extent can we elegantly miniaturize things in biology and brains? So first of all, as I said earlier, primate societies are actually negligibly large in most cases, except our own. Of course, insect societies are sort of start at the lower end where primates end. So the guys that I work with, mostly bumblebees, are up to a few hundred. Honeybees, 40,000 individuals. Wasps, up to millions. There's an ant colony that has several hundred million individuals. Now you might say, well, but everything's obviously different in insects. And some things are, some things aren't, as you'll see hopefully later in this talk. But first of all, I think if you take a big picture message, then this clearly shows that you can build relatively large societies with relatively little brain. Now, first of all, before we switch to cognition and learning and memory and so on, I think it's useful to remind ourselves that if we just look at the instinctual repertoires of social insects, then they're pretty much unparalleled anywhere in the animal kingdom, with the exception perhaps of humans. So you find in social insects these sort of complex nest architectures. This is an example of a cathedral type termite mound, complete of course with climate control and specialized nest defense systems. There isn't such a thing among the vertebrates. Okay, you find mathematically perfect solutions to honey storage and egg raising cells. Agriculture-like phenomena is in these leafcutter ants. Labor division in terms of reproduction. So here's a termite queen whose sole task essentially is laying eggs, and here's the king. There are a variety of different workers. These large-headed ones, for example, that's not large brains, that's heads full of muscle, because these are soldiers that are specialized on nest defense. Now, people will often say, well, but that's all just instinct. True, it largely is instinctual behaviors. These are not innovations that these animals have come up with through insight or learning and memory or trial and error, they've inherited them. But the point is still, to some extent, that if you ask what substrates mediate these abilities, is that they all fit into relatively little brains, whether you've come up with them by insight or evolutionary trajectories. Now, two things that bees can learn. So the first person to invest considerable time into training bees was Calvin Frisch. There he is in his Lederhosen training a bee and staring at them intently. He was actually part Jewish. The reason why he was able to continue his work through the 1930s and 40s was because the president of the German Beekeeper Society claimed that his research efforts were relevant to the war, which they clearly weren't. I don't think that his findings on training bees were actually altered the course of the war in any significant way. But anyway, so here's a figure. That's actually an original figure from the 1914 paper in which Calvin Frisch for the first time demonstrated in any animal. He also did some work on fish at the same time, but that's the same lab, that they could see color. He didn't know yet that they saw color in different ways to the way we do, but that was didn't wait too long. But anyway, so the trick is one that we're still essentially using in all our learning experiments, and that's we're giving the bees a little reward if they get something right, and either nothing or a little penalty of quinine solution if they get something wrong. So what he did here, in order to demonstrate that bees saw color, was they received a little reward in a tiny sort of glass dish on the blue dish, and then to on the blue cardboard, and then to demonstrate that they are finding that blue cardboard with some reliability was not just a question of intensity. He offered as alternatives a variety of shades of gray, to ensure that the bees wouldn't just pick something that was similarly bright. And clearly, even if you removed all the glass dishes and moved the blue target somewhere else, the little cluster of bees still gathered on the blue disc, even if, as in this case, for example, he put a glass sheet over all the cardboards, because some people at the time criticized, well, they might have used the pigment smell or something like that. So that essentially, of course, is the reason why bees are good at that sort of thing is because that's what they do on a daily basis in nature. They're naturally born color choosers and have to be careful shoppers in the floral supermarket because different species differ in reward offerings. And bees have to remember the ones that are particularly rewarding and discard the ones from their foraging efforts that are not demonstrably not rewarding. Now, Calvin Frisch also investigated a very special form of social learning, albeit a highly one that's highly constrained by instinctual behavior, but it's that this dance language, as some people call it, is still a form of social learning. Now, since if you're mostly rodent people, I expect that I need to probably remind you of how this dance language works. So if you open up the hive and replace one of its sidewalls with a glass pane and look inside, then what you often see is that bees will engage in these repetitive motor displays, roughly figure eight shaped, where they're running ahead in a straight line, doing a half circle to left, then running again in a straight line, then half circle to the right, and so on. So doing the same thing often for several minutes. And that behavior had been known for centuries, actually. It's interesting that a German cleric who had observed this in the 18th century actually knew the link between that behavior and them finding good food sources and thought that these dances were an expression of happiness, of joy, of having found something wonderful. Now there's a clear example of the kinds of pitfalls that you might fall into if you're interpreting animal behavior into human terms, because as it was discovered by von Frisch, this motor pattern is instead a symbolic code to inform other individuals of the hive of the location at which that forager had discovered a good food source. And here's how it works. So the key element is this straight waggle run in the center that can continue for a few centimeters and a few seconds. which tells individuals where the food is. And so there is a there are separate codes essentially for direction and distance. Distance is encoded essentially as the duration of this waggle run. The longer that run, the further away the food. In Apis mellifera, the European honeybee, roughly corresponding about a second to a kilometer. So if they're waggling straight ahead for 5 seconds, that means to other bees attending the dance fly 5 kilometers. If that waggle run is 2 seconds, then it's 2 kilometers away and so on. With the, that's a rough rule of thumb, but that's roughly how it works. The direction code is a little more complicated because it implies a transposition between different sensory modalities, gravity and sun compass. And so you have to imagine that the hive is, the combs on which these dances take place are vertical, and it's dark in there, and so a useful reference inside the hive is gravity. And it's so the way it works is that, again, if we're looking at the central waggle run that's pointed to the right here, if that points straight up in the darkness of the hive, then that means to dance attendees fly in the direction of the sun. If it points straight down, that tells others fly opposite the sun. And any angle in between is the direction relative to the sun, transposed from the direction relative to gravity. So inside the hive, if the direction to gravity is, say, 45 degrees to the right, then that means to bees that attend the dance and then leave the hive, 45 degrees to the right of the sun, as in this little image here. Okay, up means fly to the sun, down means fly away from the sun. Anything in between means fly that angle to the sun as it has inside the hive relative to gravity. And that, of course, is a form of social
right,
learning.
The
same. So if the angle is 45 degrees to the right of the vertical, that means to bees attending the dance 45 degrees to the right of the sun. Yeah? If it was twisted the other way, 45 degrees to the left of gravity, that would be 45 degrees to the left of the sun. What that means, of course, is that the dance for the same location changes in the course of the day. So the same, if you have a location, target location due south, then in the morning that might be 90 degrees to the right of the sun, whereas in at noon it's in the direction of the sun, and in the afternoon 90 degrees to the left of the sun. It changes with the time of day. Now that is a form of social learning insofar as the dance attendees or recruits, as honeybee people will call them, have to memorize the information, decode it, and then apply it in spatial and temporal removal from the act of picking it up. Okay, they're memorizing the information during the dance and then applying it later on. Now this dance language, it's a relatively primitive language, if it can be that at all. It essentially has words for direction and distance, and of course it is very much unlike human language in that there is not an arbitrary correspondence between meaning and symbol, and also the number of symbols is very limited. That same dance language is used in an even more complex social learning phenomenon, and that's when bees decide on where to live next. Honeybees are quite unusual in their propagation behavior in that it's not young individuals that venture out into the foreign world to find a new place to live, but old individuals. It's the old queen with a number of thousands of seasoned foragers that leaves the hive when the hive is at its most abundant to locate a new home location. And that's a complex process because the swarm consists of thousands of individuals. They don't know where to go, so initially they send out dozens and dozens of foragers over a territory that might be several square kilometers. And these all come back with conflicting information. One of them might have found a nice hollow tree, another one a chimney. One's too large, one's too small, and so on. And they come back with that information. Ultimately, they all have to decide on one option. Okay, there's no option of living by yourself if you're a honeybee. And so they have to find a consensus. And that consensus building process is described in this figure by Martin Lindauer. that was work that was later continued very beautifully with Tom Seeley. But this is a 1950s figure of a three-day consensus building process in a honeybee swarm. And so the center of the swarm is essentially that dot here, and the arrows pointing in different directions indicate locations advertised by scouts that have found something and bringing back this information to the hive. And the width of the arrows corresponds to the popularity of the site. So the fatter the arrow, the more individuals have indicated a particular site. And so you can see that that initially the opinions are quite divergent until there are fewer and fewer opinions, and in the end there's just one. And so initially, for example, the most popular location here is due east. That gradually fades, and the southerly location that bees seem to like for some time. But also already here, in this each of these panels there's a two-hour interval, by the way, so already in this panel there's a southeast location. Initially, not so many bees indicated, then more it fades a little bit, then they get more and more. And finally, all individuals of the entire swarm indicate just one target. And at that point, the swarm lifts off and they fly to the new destination. So the same kind of symbolic code here is used in a very complicated consensus building process. Well, it's elegantly simple in that it requires no individuals that count votes. It requires no individuals that even singly make decisions. The way it works essentially is by a stochastic process where individuals with better information will advertise it for longer. So if an individual has found a so-so location, they'll just, because you never know whether a better location will ever be found, they advertise it, but only briefly. So they might go there, 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 and then abandon their dance. Whereas an individual that's found a really good location will be persistent, go there for several minutes. And what that means is that each individual that walks around randomly on the swarm is more likely to bump into an individual that has better information than into one that has only so-so information. And then once a newly informed individual has attended a dance, they'll fly out, inspect the same location, and with the same correlation will advertise it for longer than an individual with a poor location information. So the whole system snowballs until they all fly off to one location. Better means each individual makes an inspection, not whether it's more popular, but whether it's better. And that means, for example, the cavity can't be too small or too large. The entrance hole shouldn't be too large or too small. The humidity needs to be just right. So each individual makes its own decision. No one counts how popular anything is. It's a wholly decentralized decision-making process. There is certainly some noise in the system, and I suspect some subjectivity, but by and large the system works well enough for them to converge on the best location so far as people have been able to test that experimentally. And finally, Lindauer, so that was Calvin Frisch's most successful student, actually explored the possibility of a tradition-like phenomenon in honeybees, and this is what he did. So this is preliminary data, and Lindauer was aware of that. He never published it in anything more than Wolfgang Kirchner's PhD dissertation, but this is what they did. So they trained bees to certain foraging locations at certain times of day, either early in the morning or midday or evening, and bees learned that well enough. So they learned that there was food at a certain time of day and not other times of day, as you can see in these distributions of foragers arriving at the feeding locations. And then he, from the colonies that he had so entrained, removed the brood combs, put them in a climatized room to hatch under controlled climate decisions, but in removal from their natal colony, and then put these bees into a new colony that had never been exposed to these temporal foraging patterns. And he found that's the new population, or next generation if you wish, that the bees that hailed from an early riser colony also had their activity peak early in the morning, or the midday ones found midday most popular, and the evening ones the evening. So there was a transfer of information from older forager, two larvae that at that time had never seen the light of day, that apparently then displayed this behavior as adults. And Lindauer thought, but never further experimentally tested it, that that this might be a result of substrate vibration, where dancing bees vibrate the combs in which these larvae are sitting, and that these larvae might have picked up the vibration signals that later told them when to forage. So much for the history class. Now, there in this dance behavior, of course, is a completely unique behavior that's found nowhere else in its symbolic content anywhere in the animal kingdom. And needless to say, neuroscientists were interested in finding, well, where's that in the brain? Where's the dance module? Is there a specialized circuit that mediates this behavior and its interpretation? And long story short, Axel Brockmann and Gene Robinson found no dance-specific predictions relative to those previously described for drone and queen honeybees and other insect species that do not exhibit dance communication. And this emphasizes, I think, a motive that will come up in a variety of times in my talk today and on Thursday, that presumably you can get relatively large shifts in cognitive behavioral capacities with minor tweakings without actually changing around your gross neuroanatomy. So, to social learning conditions in the field. So if you're a little bee venturing out from your hive for the first time, and then there's typically a bewildering variety of flowering species to choose from. There might be several dozen in any one bee colony's flight range if you're in a healthy flowery habitat. And there are a variety of ways of how you can find the best ones. One is individual exploration, so you sample all of these species, but that costs lots of time. An alternative shortcut is to have a look where, on which species or which patches there is some foraging activity by conspecifics, because if that is the case, then at least with some probability that indicates that that particular plant species might deliver food that's suitable for members of your species. Leave aside for the moment that, of course, an overexploited patch might have less food than one that's freshly, that no one else has discovered yet, but discovering your own patch is a long shot. So you could just check which species or which patches conspecifics are foraging from. And that idea that bees could learn from conspecifics in the field, again, isn't entirely novel. In fact, Charles Darwin observed nectar-robbing bumblebees and honeybees. So what's nectar-robbing? So here's one of Ellie Leadbeater's syringe flower hybrids. And of course, what a flower wants a bee to do is that the bee enters through the front orifice of the flower, and in the process of removing nectar or pollen, also touches the reproductive parts of the flower and thus delivers a service for the flower. Now, that is not what the bee is interested in. The bee just wants the reward and will take whatever shortcut it typically can get to obtain the reward. And so often short-tongued bees, like these bumblebees, Bombus terrestris, will actually just bite a hole in the spur in the tube of the flower and extract the nectar without actually pollinating the flowers. So that's one of the tricks that they can learn. And Darwin suggested that not only could bumblebees learn that from each other, perhaps, but even honeybees could pick it up from bumblebees. And I'll just read out what he said, because I think it's quite interesting how he phrased that. He thought that the hive bees either saw the humblebees cutting the holes and understood what they were doing and immediately profited by their labor, or that they merely imitated the humblebees after they cut the holes. Should this be verified, it will be a very instructive case of acquired knowledge in insects. We should be astonished did one genus of monkeys adopt from another a particular manner of opening hard-shelled fruit. How much more so ought we to be in a tribe of insects, so preeminent for their instinctive faculties, which are generally supposed to be in inverse ratio to the intellectual. So he's quite bold there in likening insects to primates, in using words like understanding and imitation and so on. And of course, he didn't have any scholarly evidence at the time beyond his observations, but nonetheless, it's interesting that he's not shy of using similar types of behavior observation that might be observed in both of these lineages and just classifying them in similar ways. Now, this sort of learning by observation really does happen to some extent. So one of the paradigms in which we test bees is this flower array where you have two flower species, one orange, one green in this case. And you can see that orange is very popular, whereas green is not. And the reason is that we're providing sucrose rewards on orange but not green. And clearly the bees pick that up. Now here's a poor little bee that's locked up all by itself behind the glass screen. And that bee wants to get there but can't because we're preventing it too. Then we're taking all these artificial flowers away and we're taking the bees away and then just presenting fresh artificial flowers and asking that bee, what do you choose? And sure enough, they'll pick orange over yellow, over green and vice versa, depending on where they've seen the activity. So at least in that case, they haven't experienced a reward while they're viewing these flowers, which is interesting enough, and one might therefore think that it has something to do with understanding or imitation, but we think that particular behavior actually can be explained quite simply by associative learning, albeit a two-step associative learning process. And this is how we think that works. So first of all, our bees have the opportunity in these flight arenas to realize that conspecifics are often associated with where the reward is. And so what then happens is that the appearance of a conspecific becomes a conditioned stimulus. They learn that where there's another bee, you get a reward. Okay, so that's your CS1. They now know where there's bees of my species, there's a reward. Then we're putting our observer bee into the observation chamber, and then they see conditioned stimulus 1, conspecific, in association with a flower type. And they observe that for some time, and then you take the conspecifics away, but what they can have done while we're looking through the window is linking CS1 and CS2, linking conspecific to a flower type. And then if you take CS1 away, the conditioned stimulus 1, then what they see is this flower, and because that has been linked through the conspecific with reward, they're picking the flower type. So it's associative learning just in two steps. So at that level, it's still fairly simple. It gets a little complex with tasks where we're now taking a deliberate step away from the kinds of tasks that bees naturally encounter. Because we're often in discussions with primate people and corvid people and so on, have that slightly dismissive perspective, saying, well, all this learning that you've tested with bees on colors and odors, that's just what they do in nature all the time anyway. So we decided, well, we'll just test the bees in the same tasks as the primate people test them also. So here's a string pulling task. These flowers are under a glass table, and the only way for a bee to get a reward is to pull out the flower from underneath the glass table by one of the strings. So there's a bee doing the pulling. And you can see that this was the first bee we ever trained on this task, so she's still not super skilled, but now she's found the reward and sucking it up. But more remarkably, we can train bees both in these kinds of observation chambers, but also in direct interactions. So the bee marked with the red dot here is one that knows the task. The other one is naive and hasn't done it yet. This one knows how to pull a string, the one with the red dot. But you can see that the second bee is very interested in what the trained bee is doing. And in the end, once the trained bee's pulled out the flower, the observer just essentially scrounges on the efforts of the demonstrator, of the skilled bee, and now they're sucking the nectar together happily without the naive observer having made any particular effort at this stage. And we always paired one naive with one experienced bee. You can see now the experienced bees is getting a little antsy because the reward's up. So we've made the reward small enough so that they have to empty several flowers. The naive bee has no idea what to do, so she's still thinking there might be a little bit more. But you can see that she's searching. Now she's running over again to the skilled bee and again sharing the reward without having contributed anything. But if you do that multiple times, the naive bees will almost invariably learn the technique from the skilled demonstrators. And so if you seed colonies with a single trained individual, no one else in that colony has encountered the task previously, then over time, over several dozen pairwise pairings, always one skilled with one unskilled bees, the majority of BCS3 colonies in the average curve of blue will learn the task so that after about 100 bouts, over 50% of the bees will all be string pullers. Sorry. There are a variety of ways. They're most efficient if they learn it from another bumblebee. That's the fastest. If we train them, then typically we do it in a shaping kind of way where we first make the flowers openly accessible and then gradually push them under the glass table. A very tiny minority, so 2 out of over 100 that we tested actually solved it spontaneously. But that requires lots of trial and error, and it's very, very clumsy. The video material is all on the PLOS Biology paper website, so you can see some bees can do it spontaneously, but it takes a very, very long time. And so what you can do, you can analyze the spread of the social information in this sort of network diagram, in which in this case we've arranged all the individuals of one colony in a circle. Each dot is one individual in the colony, and the single seeded demonstrator is at the top, marked in yellow. And each individual is a gray dot. It turns white the moment they have first interacted with a trained demonstrator. Here has just had a single exposure. This one just had its first exposure. And the dots turn colored the moment the target individual for the first time does the string pulling task. And so what is happening here is that you can see all these orange individuals have learned the task from the first generation learner, the first learner that was ever inserted into the colony. But by now, there are some other colors showing up here. There's a purple individual. And the second, that purple color means that that's a second generation learner. They have not learned it from, or a third generation if you wish, they have not learned it from individual one, but now from other individuals that were trained by individual one. And so if you let this continue over time, then in fact in this case there were 4 generations of learners after the initial trained individual, and even after that first individual passed away, sadly. They do that, they only live 3 weeks. The skill continued to spread inside the colony. So you find, in that sense, so Lindau's idea of a tradition in his case, in honeybees, indeed, we confirmed by careful experimentation, in that there's now a group-specific skill that only individuals of that group can master, but not any other ones, and of course that also this skill persists over generations. Of course, these are not biological generations, in that one generation is not parents to the next generation, but they're sequential sets of skilled individuals. So there are 2 big questions that interest us, and I'm going to answer neither of them, but I'll spend the rest of today and Thursday bouncing some ideas around. So one, of course, is how do little brains achieve such capacities? And a sort of second one is how computationally demanding are they actually? Are they difficult in computational terms? Are they hard to evolve? How many neural parallel processes, sequential processing stages, and so on might we need for them? I think we need to answer them rather than just being impressed with remotely human-like capacities. Now, bee brains are undoubtedly small. So here's a frontal view of a bee's head with the brain exposed. This antenna here, that's a bee's nose. I recently made the mistake and say these telephone dial-like arrangements, and they got very blank looks from most of the audience because many of the younger people have never seen a telephone like that. So that's how telephones used to look. This circular arrangement here is the primary olfactory relay, where the inputs from like olfactory receptors are summed up before they're processed further and then sent on to the mushroom bodies, which are shown here in blue, which are thought to be centers of learning and memory and multisensory integration and so on. The structures in green are the optic lobes with ganglia, lamina, medulla, and lobula. And so among the many things that you can do in order to minimize things elegantly is to minimize the number of neurons that do the same thing at any one time. And so, for example, in this particular neuron here that was identified by Martin Hammer in Randolph Menzel's lab in the 1990s, in the subesophageal ganglion with ramifications through the antennal lobes and the mushroom bodies, it appears that this single cell is the reward pathway. Okay, one cell signals reward, whereas, of course, in the dopaminergic reward system in mammals, there might be thousands of cells all saying the same thing at a time. Now, people then often say, well, but that's risky. If you have a stroke, what are you going to do to replace that one cell? Maybe that is risky, but bees only live 3 weeks, and I don't know if a stroke is that likely during that time. So in fine terms, there is plenty of room at the bottom. There's plenty of room to minimize things elegantly. Now, one little warning, insect brains are not simple. Okay, I often see that in grant applications, and actually I've been guilty of that little white lie myself, to convince funding agencies that we study insects because their brains are simple. It's actually nonsense. Their brains are small, and they have relatively lower numbers of neurons than, of course, say, a rodent does or a primate does, for sure. But of course, each of their nerve cells, be they 100,000 as in Drosophila or a million in bees, might still have the structure of a fully grown oak tree with many thousand connections from each single cell to other cells and so on. So here's a figure from Inchen Jiang's connectome, fly connectome. I think this sort of carries the message that this isn't simple. Yeah, there might be fewer neurons, but it's far from just a trivial challenge. Now, that social brain hypothesis that I mentioned initially and is today in today's sort of behavioral ecology textbooks often credited to Dunbar and other vertebrate behavioral ecologists was actually first coined by Félix Dujardin in 1850, who investigated insects, and this is a translation from my postdoc Mathieu Lihoreau. And so Dujardin observed that as intelligence dominates over instinct, the mushroom bodies and the antennal lobes become considerably larger relative to overall brain volume, as we see when comparing cockchafers to locusts, solitary bees, and finally social bees, where the mushroom bodies represent 1/5 of the brain and 1/940 of the body, whereas in cockchafers they represent less than 1/33,000 of the body. So it's interesting that the whole toolkit that today's comparative brain architecture people, i.e. comparing certain areas and setting them in relation to other areas, were already there. And his observation was that these mushroom bodies, which he thought are the seat of intelligence, interestingly enough, are particularly enlarged in honeybees. Good idea, but was he right? So here's a honeybee brain. You will now, by now, hopefully be sort of used to what's what. So on the sides here again are the olfactory lobes, and at the top the mushroom bodies. And on top, that's our honeybee, Apis mellifera. In comparison, here's a similarly sized solitary bee, whose mushroom bodies are just as large. Okay, 40,000 individuals maybe in that species, one individual here, same size mushroom bodies. Here's a bumblebee, which is thought to be primitively eusocial and clearly doesn't have things like the dance language and so on. And you can see not only is its overall brain much larger, but also its mushroom bodies are much larger. So there isn't actually a clear distinction. And Sarah Ferris and Suzanne Schulmeister have done this a little bit more systematically, comparing lots and lots of different Hymenoptera and species. Hymenoptera include ants, bees, wasps, sawflies, and found a picture that is completely unlinked in terms of mushroom body architecture to sociality. They found that all the so-called basal or the and representative of these basal species are all phytophagous, so that is, these insects are solitary and deposit eggs on vegetation where their larvae consume it. And all these phytophagous species have relatively simple, small mushroom bodies, whereas all the other Hymenoptera, everything that starts from about here, has larger and more convoluted mushroom bodies. And the change that happened here at this transition from simple mushroom bodies to complex one is not one from solitary to social, but one in lifestyle, from phytophagy to eating, to letting your larvae consume other insects. And so all of these are parasitoids or their derivatives. And so at that transition, when I guess your prey is a bit more difficult to locate and to overwhelm, that's where big mushroom bodies evolved, hundreds of thousands of years before you found sociality in that little branch on the right there, in some ants and wasps. And indeed, the challenges that solitary species often cope with are equivalent or larger than those encountered by social species. So most or all social species of insects have one home. Okay, so they need to just replace, they need to remember one place with certainty, because if they don't find their home, then of course their foraging efforts are lost to the colony. But that challenge is of course greater in solitary species, because if a honeybee loses one member of its hive, then okay, we still have 60,000 others. If you're a solitary species and you don't find your nest, your fitness is back to zero, basically. Okay. Interestingly, some solitary species have more than one nest, and they need to remember all of the nesting locations. And here's an example of a parasitoid wasp studied by Behrens, who was a student of Tinbergen's, which makes these burrows in sand, then puts a little pebble into the hole and brushes sand over the pebble, so it becomes essentially invisible. Now, in a few square meters, there might be 100 different nests by different individuals, and 3 or 4 by one individual. They're practically invisible, and the locations look to any observer indistinguishable until the individuals remove the pebble and climb into their little holes. They don't just have to remember where the holes are, but also what they've done with them, because in each individual hole, they deposit between one very large caterpillar to up to 7 really small ones for the little babies to consume. And so they need to tailor the efforts of provisioning on what and when they've already provisioned to these same holes. And that, in essence, I don't know if you are familiar with the work by Nikki Clayton and so on food storing corvids, where she says that these kinds of what, where, when memories are a form of episodic memories. The challenge is exactly the same here. They have to remember where something is, what they've put in, and when they've put it in. Just the quantity is very different. The complexity is the same. The quantity of locations stored is smaller, undoubtedly, but the challenge is just the same. And so I suspect that many of the learning abilities that we study in social bees, for the simple reason that they are available in large numbers and easy to experiment with, are actually not linked to social lifestyles in general. So many of the learning feats that we measure in say bees and wasps are just as relevant to solitary as well as social species. And spatial learning, for example, learning where your nest is doesn't depend on whether there's a 1,000 individuals or one in your nest. You have to do it either way. And so this mushroom body elaboration seems to have happened at the transition from phytophagy to a parasitoid lifestyle, not in a link to sociality. So many of the cognitive feats that have been discussed in the insects, for example, accounting-like ability, I'll talk to you more about that on Thursday, and sequence learning and sort of simple spatial concepts and so on, have nothing to do with sociality. These are all intelligence tests, if you wish, that have been derived from primate work, but are actually there's no apparent link with sociality. Now, the first thing that you need to build a society is actually not complex at all. You need a label that identifies everyone in the society. You need something, a common feature that allows you to tell that individual belongs to us and that other one doesn't. does not, and that's clear with these sorts of tribal costumes. These bottom two tribes are now extinct, which is a pity in that case, because I was one of them once. So the point here is that all you need is a label. If you want to build a large society, so long as you have that label, you can make your society as large as you want to, no limits. And that, of course, is precisely what insects typically do. So often the common label is by odor, where individuals at the nest entrance are inspected by a guard bee in this case, and they just smell out any kind of intruders. And Nick Bose and Patrizia De Torre have made elegantly clear that the learning ability required for that is very basal. You can get by with habituation, just a decreased response to your own odor as opposed to others. Now, some, not all social insects identify themselves by olfaction. There are some that use visual signals. And here's an example of Brazilian Partamona bees, which use white river sand that they collect only from river banks that contain white sand, and make such a construction that they glue together with spittle and resin, and where each construction marks one individual nest entrance, so they remember what their nest looks like, and that's their common social label. Now, that said, there is in some species of insects individual recognition, and now we're no longer so far apart from the primates that Dunbar is interested in. The way these these Polistyne wasps work, that's worked largely by, that was spearheaded by Liz Tibbetts about 15 years ago and has since been expanded by a number of others. The colonies are small, there might be only a dozen individuals, and they have a linear hierarchy where one individual monopolizes reproduction. But the society, it's more plastic than, say, in honeybees, in that if that alpha female dies, for example, then everyone moves up a step. And these hierarchies are established by individual fights, one-on-one duels, which are costly. They're extended in time. Rarely, it's rare that an individual gets killed, but they might certainly lose an antenna or something like that. And so it's best not to be to repeat such a confrontation if you already know you're going to lose against individual X. So they have an individual memory that is linked to these highly individual facial features. So these are not different species, but two individuals of the same species. Likewise, these four here are all members of one colony, just different facial features in each individual. So there's an insect that remembers those are the bad guys and those are the good guys, so to speak, depending on whether you can win or lose against them. We did an experiment some time ago, which is slightly tongue-in-cheek, but we were interested in whether honeybees can recognize images of human faces. So we trained them, as we always do, with a little droplet of sucrose solution in association with one face, and then gave them a variety of different ones, with spatial positions we rotated so to make sure that they could get the right one. At the time, we were interested in whether the debate at the time was whether face recognition in humans is a sort of generalized expert skill or whether it requires specialized circuitry. But interestingly, that result got us attention from the U.S. Air Force, because at the time, face recognition software wasn't yet that good, and so I had this slightly menacing dude in my office who wanted to offer me lots of money to figure out how bees do it. I said no thank you, but it was an interesting encounter. Adrian Dyer even showed that he could get bees to, if he trained them to two rotated versions, then he could get them to the bees to recognize the intermediate version. Now, faces are not special things for bees, and this is just a strange flower. It's a visual pattern that's linked to a reward in this case. And the reason bees are good at rotating these things is because that, again, is something they have to do in nature, albeit with flower patterns, because if you just memorize a pixel-by-pixel image that you can't recognize from any other distance or angle, you're screwed. So you want to be able to recognize patterns from different angles in order to forage adaptively. So in many cases, of course, these abilities that we test will have natural analogs in some way. Now, when Liz Tibbetts first found face recognition in her wasps, She then teamed up with Wulfila Gronenberg, an eminent neuroscientist in Tucson, to see, well, where's the face recognition module in the wasp brain. And so she compared several species of wasps that engage in face recognition with close relatives that don't, and found no difference. Okay, so there's again a unique ability that you find nowhere else in insects, no difference, at least in gross neuroanatomy, of these face recognizing species, which I guess again emphasizes the idea that presumably they're just co-opting an ability they have anyway for visual pattern recognition of prey or landmarks and so on, and wiring it into a social context which presumably works with quite minor wiring differences. Now, is face recognition difficult or special in computational terms? Probably not, actually. Here's an example of a paper by Aitken and McDonald with essentially a minimal neural network with just coincidentally, in terms of spatial resolution, coincides with roughly a bee's image, so it had 32 by 32 pixels, two hidden layers and two output neurons which said yes, correct face, no, incorrect face. With that really, really minimal network, okay, so this is 1,000 pixels plus 550 interneurons, they got 95% accuracy with 100 faces. Okay, at that level, face recognition is not expensive, not complex. With these few hundred neurons, you could stick that in a Drosophila brain, you wouldn't see a difference. Okay, it might be different if you want to recognize faces independent of emotional states and rotationally and so on, but at that basic level, it's actually not very difficult. So often what you do get in bigger brains, it's just more of the same. So if you add more pixels, then for every pixel that you add, you need additional motion detectors, edge detectors, brightness detectors, color opponent neurons, and so on. The same toolkit replicated multiple times over. So you're not adding complexity, you're just adding detail to the image. More of that on Thursday. I wanted to finish with a study that we've just published, which is a study of social learning of a kind of token or tool use behavior. And so here the task was that bees had to move an item from an arbitrary location to a goal in order to get a reward. And so here, that's again, it's the first individual that we ever trained, but there she goes. And once she's done it successfully in the middle, then a little lid opens and she gets the reward underneath. So that proved to us that certainly you don't need a big brain to play football. Sorry, I was never good at sports, so this is my little revenge on my classmates who were better at it. But interestingly, they could. So we then engaged them in various social learning protocols, and we played a little trick on the demonstrator. And of course, if you've got three balls, each with a different distance from the center, then the best way to solve this task is to take the closest ball and roll that in the middle. And the trick we played was that for the skilled bees, for the demonstrators in this case, is that this ball were glued down, so they couldn't be moved. So that demonstrator knew, I can't move these, I have to pick that one. But this is a naive individual that actually hasn't solved the task before. And so what that naive individual observed and got to see was a suboptimal solution to the problem every time. So here's how that worked in general. So here's the skilled bee rolling the ball, the other one's running after, and now they both get a little reward. Nice music. Anyway, so here they're both happily drinking the reward, but now we're taking the demonstrator away, we unglue the balls, and the naive individual now gets a choice between three balls, and sure enough, it picks the closest ball. So interestingly, the observer there wasn't just stupidly aping the demonstrator bee, it observed the right thing, it knew what to do, but it solved it in a better way than they had seen the demonstrator observe. And this is, I guess, one scenario where we don't actually have a simple sort of associative learning explanation, because what the observers there do is indeed quite remarkable and removed from just using stimulus configurations to get to reward. Also, if we change the colors of the ball, so if we offered the closest ball, say in black, for example, they'd still pick the closest ball. All right. Some conclusions. So I think so far, at least, and that I think also emerges if you ask computational neuroscientists, the task that requires a big brain actually hasn't been discovered yet. You can do lots of things with relatively little brains. And in terms of the social brain hypothesis that Desjardins coined for insects in 1850, it seems that mushroom body elaboration at least predated the evolution of sociality quite substantially. I suspect that many of these abilities that later on came useful in organizing a society might already have existed in, and that includes spatial memory, of course, in parasitoids that were brood provisioning. These abilities were there before sociality. Now, interestingly, there seem to be few, if any, changes in gross brain neuroanatomy that are linked to sociality, so which I guess indicates that you can do quite drastic shifts in behavioral capacities with small tweakings that are actually not apparent in just volumetric measurements of various brain parts. But I guess on the whole, beyond the level that comparative cognition workers are often just impressed with human-like abilities, what we actually really want to understand is, for ability X, what do you actually need? How many neurons, how many, what kind of connectivity, how many sequential processing stages, and so on. We'd heard from earlier on from a physicist about pinhead-sized storage devices, and the pinhead comes here again in a citation by Darwin. This is about ants, but not about bees, but it fits so well that I'll read it back to you anyway. So Darwin said that it is certain that there may be an extraordinary activity with an extremely small absolute mass of nervous matter. Thus, the wonderfully diversified instincts, mental powers, and affection of ants are notorious, yet their cerebral ganglia are not so large as the quarter of a small pin's head. Under this point of view, the brain of an ant is one of the most marvelous atoms of matter in the world, perhaps more so than the brain of man. Now, that would have been provocative in 1871 to say that an ant brain is more impressive than a human brain, but clearly the man was not too shy of offending his contemporaries. Thanks very much. Ah, okay. So this is an original Darwin quote. I don't know if you've heard of John Lubbock. John Lubbock was a famous politician, banker, and entomologist. He invented bank holidays, for example, but he was also the first to discover UV sensitivity in any insect. He was a neighbor and disciple of Darwin's, and they often corresponded about ideas. And in this case, Darwin had suggested to John Lubbock a particular idea about how nectar-robbing bees might interact with clover and shape its evolution, and asked John Lubbock to test that idea. And a few days later, Darwin realized that he had actually made a profound logical mistake in that interaction, and then wrote this slightly self-destroying message to John Lubbock, basically saying, well, don't bother, it was a stupid idea. That's a good question. So clearly in the dark, you can't see the dance, so you have to feel it. And so it works by a number of individuals essentially touching the dancing bee on its bottom and following around for the whole dance circuit. and of course, that drastically limits the number of individuals that can attend the dance at any one time. So four or five that can follow a dancing bee for a given amount of time. But of course, because the dances often persist for several minutes, several individuals can sequentially attend them.
Has vocal communication been ruled out in bees?
Not entirely. So they're not very good at hearing, and any kinds of vocal communications need to be picked up either via substrate vibrations or from very close. But so within there are sort of brief sound pulses, for example, in the dances, and it seems that in some stingless bee species, so these are social species that live typically in the tropics, that don't have the dance language, it seems that there are sound pulses whose duration corresponds to flight distance. So there actually this vocal communication is replaced, or there's it's an alternative way to communicate the distance. There are a number of other sounds that beekeepers will be able to tell you about whose function hasn't been fully analyzed, but it seems there certainly isn't a very rich language. Interestingly, John Lubbock, whom I just mentioned, did a really fantastic experiment in the 19th century. This was after Alexander Graham Bell came to Britain to demonstrate to the Queen the newly invented telephone. And John Lubbock at the time had already observed that if he pokes a stick in an anthill, then there seems to be an alarm message that spreads very quickly. And he thought that there might be some sort of inaudible sound communication going on. So he invited Bell over to test the newly developed telephone on an entomological experiment by holding the microphone up to the disturbed anthill and the loudspeaker up to a second anthill. So before, and the result was negative, of course, and so before telephone was used for mass communication, it was actually used in an ant experiment. But the negative result then prompted Lubbock to postulate the idea that there might be a chemical language in ants, which of course proved very powerful. They're pretty deaf ants, actually.
We will have artificial intelligence. We don't need to do anything. We don't need to really explore even more. Just wait. So I think a very interesting case for this is bees. We now have the computational ability to simulate brains of this magnitude. We have the computers that can do this. Do we have, for just a simple, I would say, a robot that can do mimic most of the things that bees can do, do you think?
We don't yet. We've just been given some funding from an engineering council because they believed us that we might be able to reproduce some such abilities in unmanned aerial vehicles, albeit substantially larger than real bees are. Whether we have the computational power, maybe. So we're now able to run reasonably realistic models of bee olfaction and its connection to the mushroom body, but I think we're still a long way away from whole brain simulations for a functioning bee brain, including all the multitasking that goes on in the juggling of the richness of the instinctual repertoire in addition to the cognitive capacities. But we're working on it.
Okay, let's thank the speaker.